soul. All fire me a preach, boy, singing glory, hallelujah, when the fire came. Oh, when the fire came. Oh, when the fire came. Singing glory, hallelujah, when the fire came. And the Lord sanctified me. Yeah, your fire just a burn, Lord Jesus. Your fire just a burn.
Children's ministry will be ablaze this convention with the power and the presence of God to impact the lives of the next generation. Sessions are on Saturday, March 30 from 9 a.m. to 12 noon, Sunday, March 31 at 9 a.m. and Monday, April 1 at 9 a.m. Take the children for the word, art and craft, soul and mind stimulating sessions, and so much more.
Lord, your fire upon me tongue, your fire in a me speech, fire heart, fire soul. Boy, fire me a preach, boy, singing glory, hallelujah, when the fire came. Oh, when the fire came. Oh, when the fire came. Singing glory, hallelujah, when the fire came. And the Lord sanctified me. Yeah, your fire just a burn, Lord Jesus. Your fire.
Children's ministry will be ablaze this convention with the power and the presence of God to impact the lives of the next generation. Sessions are on Saturday, March 30 from 9 a.m. to 12 noon, Sunday, March 31 at 9 a.m. and Monday, April 1 at 9 a.m. Take the children for the word, art and craft, soul and mind stimulating sessions, and so much more.
Head to the soul of my feet, inside and outside, all around.
around above beneath. Lord, your fire upon me tongue, your fire in me speech, fire heart, fire soul, burn fire me a preach. Boy, singing glory, hallelujah, when the fire came, oh, when the fire came, oh, when the fire came. Singing glory, hallelujah, when the fire came, and the Lord sanctify me.
Children's ministry will be ablaze this convention with the power and the presence of God to impact the lives of the next generation. Sessions are on Saturday, March 30 from 9 a.m. to 12 noon, Sunday, March 31 at 9 a.m. and Monday, April 1 at 9 a.m. Take the children for the word, art and craft, soul and mind stimulating sessions, and so much more.
Lord, your fire upon me tongue, your fire in me speech, fire heart, fire soul, burn fire me a preach. Boy, singing glory, hallelujah, when the fire came, oh, when the fire came, oh, when the fire came. Singing glory, hallelujah, when the fire came, and the Lord sanctify me. Say your fire just a burn, Lord Jesus, your fire.
It was another year of the mission Special Assignment 23, transforming the city. The people gathered for the instructions. There were special requirements for enlisting. We had to meet the criteria for service. The chief bellowed, "Can we find anyone in whom there is a spirit of God?" We prepared with consecration and the regeneration of the word. We answered the call, standing firm in our identity as soldiers of the cross. We were reminded of our history and the solid legacy on which we stood as a Foursquare army, transforming our space and standing out was in our DNA. We could not remove ourselves from the people of the city. They need the light. They need hope. Identifying with our commander-in-chief, feet geared with the gospel of peace, heavy with the message that there is salvation in no other but Jesus Christ, and burdened with the ministry of reconciliation, there we went out to give the wind a mighty voice and set the nation ablaze with the message that Jesus saves. Special Operation 24. Another year, the same mission. But some soldiers have become battle weary. Others have fallen asleep at their post. Some need to be reminded of why they first enlisted. Others need to retool and reassess. Because with each passing day, the mission of transformation becomes more intense and complex. There's an urgency to introduce a changing world to the only immutable God, the one who remains the same yesterday and today and forever. Acutely aware that the mission cannot be done in our strength, because it is not by might or power, but by the Spirit of God. This is why we are reminded to fan into flames the spiritual gift God gave to us, knowing that God has not given us a spirit of fear and timidity, but of power, love, and self-discipline. We will never be ashamed to tell others about our Lord. On this mission, we will stand in the strength God so generously pours out, ready to suffer for the sake of the gospel. For God has saved us and called us to live a holy life. He did this not because we deserved it, but because that was His plan from before the beginning of time, to show us His grace through Christ Jesus. And we stand here today, this day, at this crossroads in history, to declare that Jesus broke the power of death and illuminated the way to life and immortality through the good news.
For in the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Sons and daughters will prophesy, young men will see visions, and old men will dream dreams. As we gather for a refueling, the babies and the children cry for fresh fire. The next generation yearns for fire. Men and women call out in earnest for fresh fire. Fresh fire.
Fresh fire.
Ignite our hearts for your service, Lord.
It was another year of the mission Special Assignment 23, transforming the city. The people gathered for the instructions. There were special requirements for enlisting. We had to meet the criteria for service. The chief bellowed, "Can we find anyone in whom there is a spirit of God?" We prepared with consecration and the regeneration of the word. We answered the call, standing firm in our identity as soldiers of the cross. We were reminded of our history and the solid legacy on which we stood as a Foursquare army. Transforming our space and standing out was in our DNA. We could not remove ourselves.
Everyone.
everyone everywhere, we're just going to invite you on the inside to stand on your feet.
Hallelujah.
As we get ready for our final session in this our convention, igniting the fire of God in you. Everybody everywhere, let's stand to our feet as we get ready. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We proclaim you as holy. We proclaim you as Lord. We proclaim you as King of Kings, the conquering lion of the tribe of Judah. You are worthy of our worship. Jesus, we will bless you at all times. Your praises shall continually
hallelujah,
be in our mouth.
Hallelujah.
Mighty God, we cried unto
hallelujah.
You and you heard us. You delivered us
hallelujah.
From all our fears.
Glory.
We thank you, God,
hallelujah.
That a thousand are falling at our side.
Hallelujah.
We thank you that 10,000 are falling
hallelujah.
At our right hand, but no evil shall come near us. Only with our eyes, God, will we behold and see the reward of the wicked. We thank you that you give your angels charge over us, lest we dash our feet against a stone. We thank you that you are our
hallelujah.
Light. We
hallelujah.
Thank you that you are our salvation. We fear no evil. Mighty God, even when wars rage against us, we are confident because your name is a rock. Your name is a strong tower. You are our hiding place. Can somebody worship the King of Kings? Extol his name, for he is great. And his mercies endure forever. Is there somebody with a testimony of what God has done for you, of what Yahweh has done in your life? Hallelujah. Jesus. I don't know if this is the same protocol in different churches, church branches, but before we go into worship, we always like to do a consecration prayer, because prayer is the key to open any door. So I'm inviting you to raise your hands as we are about to pray before we get into this final session. Father, in the powerful name
hallelujah.
Of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we thank you for overcoming the grave.
Jesus.
We thank you that through you we have, Almighty Father, the power to tread upon scorpions, to tread upon the others. We thank you that you have given us power over the enemy himself. We thank you in this hour that whatsoever we bind here on earth is bound in the heavenly realms, and whatsoever we loose here on earth, whatever we loose in the heavens, we loose in the earth. God, we thank you in this moment that, Father, principalities, demons, oh God, are subject to your name. So we pray that you loose the spirit
hallelujah.
Of worship, that you loose your people to praise and magnify your name,
hallelujah.
For you have done marvelous things. You have done exceedingly abundantly above all we could ever imagine or think, because your power that works in us, oh God, effects the change. And so, God, as we come for worship, God,
hallelujah.
We take a posture, Jesus, bowing before you. We bow our hearts before you, God. We bow our hearts before you. We say, receive our worship, God. May, oh God, the fragrance of our worship rise in the heavenly realms. May, oh God, our worship tear down Jericho wall. May our worship confuse the enemy this afternoon in the powerful name of Jesus. As we worship, God, we pray that you release your angels to encamp round about us, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Jesus.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
And so as we are in this presence, as we are in his presence, hallelujah, we just want to bow down and indeed worship Yahweh.
We bow down and worship Yahweh.
Can somebody sing And Lord of Lords, this rock is Jesus.
on earth, hallowed be thy name.
Oh, Father, oh, Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom
come on earth, thy will be done on earth, hallowed be thy name.
Let's hear the church proclaim it. Oh, your praise is a chant of victory over preaching now, but when I say hallelujah, I need a greater response from the audience. Hallelujah, Shanda, because I believe that your praise is something that can break limitations in the realm of the spirit. Hallelujah. So when the praise team say hallelujah, we want the congregation to respond with a bigger hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Let's go. One, two, three. Hallelujah. This final one, we're putting you in the mode of reflection as to what the Lord has accomplished so far and what he's about to do as he ignites your fire. The fire of God is nothing to play with. Hallelujah. And if you're desirous, hallelujah, Jesus, he will keep you blazing and blazing. Hallelujah. As you yield to him.
I come just now to say thank you, O King. You are not just a part of my life, but my everything.
Sing it, girl.
Your love reaches way down deep within, passes human understanding. There will always be a song for you, I sing. One word alone just can't express my heart's desire. Gratitude for one more day, my needs supply. Your warm embrace and tenderness, you are patient with me. You are the best. Hallelujah. To thee. Hallelujah. Oh yes, I will see. You.
Hallelujah.
Thank Hallelujah. You, Jesus. Can we give the Lord a clap offering? Hallelujah. His presence is already here. And we welcome him. Welcome Holy Spirit. Have your sweet divine way in us, God. Jesus, you are worthy of our praise. All honor belongs to your God. All praise belong to you. God, we don't know what the next second is going to be, but we say all honor belongs to you, Jesus. Even when the trials and temptation come, all honor belongs to you, oh God. Hallelujah in the trials. Hallelujah on the mountaintop. Hallelujah at Rock Baptam. Hallelujah when you exalt me. God, for you are great, almighty. You do wonders. You split red seas. You are still raising the dead. You are still making ways when there seem to be no way. Hallelujah to your God. Hallelujah to you, O God. Ignite the fire in us. Ignite your fire in us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. Keep the fire burning throughout the service. Because God is about to move mightily in this our last session. Open your hearts to receive of the Lord. Let not your flesh or your friends stop you from worshiping your God as he ignites his fire within our hearts. God bless you as we continue to worship the King of Kings in spirit and in truth. Hallelujah.
Praise the Hebrew name Yahweh. It means something. And so we gather here to celebrate Jesus. Who are we celebrating? Jesus. Who are we celebrating?
Jesus.
Call him by his name.
Jesus.
Call him again.
Jesus.
Yeah, we celebrate Jesus. What an awesome time we're having since Friday night. And Brother Clark would say him good, him good, him good, bad. We celebrate him for his goodness and for his mercies. You know, we have many of our brethren that is watching online, abroad, I think between Canada, US, and England, and all over. I always boast and I said, we have over 150 countries throughout the world where Foursquare Church is. And I want to tell you something. They watch us online. They watch us online and respond oftentimes. Sometimes they send requests for prayer from different parts of the world. We have one big family. And we give God thanks for that. All right? And before I do the part that I'm here supposed to do, I want to bring greetings from Brother and Sister Turpin. Who know Brother and Sister Turpin? Oh, Peter and the other. Oh, Peter been my good friend. We come from far, you know. Them over, so I mean, know they wish they would have been here. And also from Sister Angela Hunter. And I spoke with Alma 2 days ago, and she sent her greetings. as well. So let me tell you, we have a great big family. So let's just stay watching here. So just say, greetings, brethren. Yeah, we love you and we miss you. So we give God thanks for today, for his goodness. This is our convocation. This is our time that we take away every year to meet in the presence of the Lord. And what a time this has been. I trust God that, listen to me, the Jeremiah fire just full up inside of you, you know. And you just go back home with that kind of fire and just start burning your community among your friends and at your workplace. So let God's grace and mercy continue to flow. Oh, this is our last part of the evening. And many never come Friday night. Some never come Saturday night. Some never come yesterday. Some won't come today. So we can't make you go away back with the blessing. We can't allow you to go away with the blessings. And one of the things that, I tell you a little secret. Did you know that the more you give to God, is the more you're being blessed? And especially when you give a sacrificial offering, the blessings. And just to encourage you, I remember one Sunday morning in Newlands, I was ministering, and the Lord said, call them. And it was mostly men at this time. And I said, everything you have in your pocket, take it out. Give it to the Lord. And they did. One brother come to me after church, and he said, Sister Molins, me think you did a God bless over it and give me back. And I said, no, you don't give it to the Lord. He said, but that's all me have for God work this week. I said, prove God. That Monday evening, come a prayer meeting, he was dancing. He went to work with just a little gas in his bike. But just as he reached work, the amount of work he gets at work that wasn't associated with his work and the amount of money they give him, carry him through the week and beyond. Because sometimes you feel like the last little money we have, give it sacrificially. Don't hold on, Pani. When you lock your hand, you can't receive nothing. But when you open your hands, you receive the blessings of the Lord. So, I'm going to ask us all, reach into your pocketbook, your handbag, even if it is a gift on Friday night. And you still have given to the Lord and expect great blessing. And I expect to hear the testimony, you know, that I give all. And this is what God has done for me in convention. I'm going to ask the ushers to come in and let's just bow heads and believe God in unity. Now, whatever you have given, the blessings of God will return it to you a thousandfold. Heavenly Father, we thank you today. We thank you for your great blessings that you have blessed us, Lord, and your goodness and your mercies that you have poured over us. Just to be here, God, we celebrate you. Just to be with our brethren from various churches, God, we rejoice in you. We thank you for your power and of your love and for the team, Lord, of the fire that is inside of us. I pray in the mighty name of Jesus that as we reach in and as we give, not grudgingly, Lord, but we give with joy in our heart. We give with happiness, knowing, God, that you promise that if we give, it will press down, shaken together, and running over, that men will give in our bosom. So, Father God, as we give, I pray that it will return to all of us a thousandfold, and your blessings remain. And God, those that are sick can give. Healing will be there. Those that are depressed and give, healing will be there. Those that are financially embarrassed, healing will be there. In the mighty name of Jesus. And we bless this offering now in Jesus' name. Give unto the Lord. God bless you.
Shall we praise the Lord? Shall we praise the Lord? Hallelujah. Anybody know that God has been good to you? Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I mean, the enemy has been working on my voice since Friday night. However, I'll be ministering this song as the Holy Spirit leads. And I just want you to reflect on the goodness of God. I'm a master's student at UWE, and the devil tell me some of the paper due today. And literally, I had to be working last night just to ensure that I finalized the paper. And this morning when I woke up, I heard that the paper has been extended to April 8th. And that is the faithfulness of God that I'm talking about. So I know that God has been faithful to me. So I just wanted to reflect on the faithfulness of God as we as a choir minister unto you.
love and mercy.
Hallelujah. Indeed, a faithful God he is. Ah, yes. So I hold that down there, say she again. Then don't it in a me had for convention, me say, you are going to see me. So you are seeing me now. Over, it's just as I didn't mention how many times you'd be seeing me. But see me here. And for those afternoon persons, they had to see me. Amen? Amen. It's time for the word. Let me hear you say word. Ah, Jesus. Reverend Dr. Gareth Phillips has served as the president of the International Church of the Foursquare Gospel in Jamaica from 2016 to 2024. He is currently the senior pastor at the Kasha Park Foursquare Church in the capital city, Kingston. Since his baptism at age 10 years, he has passionately carried the anointing to deliver a clear, undiluted message about the power of God to save, heal, and deliver people from all kinds of conditions. His training and preparation has been focused on pastoral care and counseling, and the development of leadership capacity at both the individual and organizational levels. What is true is that he has fully engaged his skills and expertise to the glory of God and observes the motto, service to God's people leads to fulfilling God's ultimate plan here on earth. He loves the Lord with a genuine heart. Truth. Dr. Phillips officially came into ministry as a lay minister in 1999 at Liberty World Outreach Church in Tulsa, Oklahoma, USA. In April 2004, he was ordained a minister of religion for International Church of the Foursquare Gospel Jamaica, his home-based church. Since that time, he has served as vice president, member of the executive cabinet, district supervisor, chair of the bylaws committee, and president and faculty of Lighthouse International Foursquare Evangelism Life Bible College. Dr. Phillips earned his Bachelor of Science and Master of Arts degrees from the Oral Roberts University in Tulsa, Oklahoma, USA, and a diploma in business education from the University of Technology, Jamaica. He holds a PhD from the University of Minnesota, Twin Cities, Minnesota, USA. He is married to Renee and has three children, Carrington, Kayana, and Kristen. Church, convention body. Just before you hear Reverend Dr. Gareth Phillips, you will be hearing from Sister Antoinette, and right after that, you'll be hearing the word from Dr. Phillips. Sister Hunter.
Praise the Lord. I really don't know how this is going to go, you know, because you can hear my voice. But the Lord does something when you come to minister. He gives you voice when there's no voice. Eh? All right, so if you know, you can sing along with me.
I hear the sound of a mighty rushing wind, and it's closer now than it's ever been, and I can almost hear the trumpet as Gabriel sounds the call at the midnight cry. We'll be going home.
I feel like doing that one more time.
Hallelujah. I hear the sound of a mighty rushing wind, and it's closer now than it's ever been, and I can almost hear the trumpet as Gabriel sounds the call midnight cry. We'll be coming home. I looked around me. I see prophecies fulfilling everywhere. Signs of a time they're appearing everywhere. I can almost hear the Father as he said, son, go get your children. The midnight cry. Ooh. We'll be going home.
Can I have the
the church ring with me. When Jesus stepped down, on the clouds to call his children, the dead in Christ shall arise to meet him in the that remain shall be quickly changed in the moment at the midnight cry. Anybody know what I'm saying? At the midnight cry, at the midnight cry, at the midnight cry, at the midnight cry. Jesus stepped down on the clouds to call his children. The dead in Christ shall arise to meet him in the air. Moment at the midnight cry, yeah, at the midnight cry, when Jesus stepped down on the clouds to call his children. Shall arise, we shall arise to meet him in the air. Oh, and then those that remain shall be quickly changed in a moment at the midnight. At the midnight cry, oh, at the midnight cry, we'll be going home. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Jump on your feet and put your hands together and give God some worship.
At the midnight cry, we will be going home. We will be going home. But until then, we've got to stay here and occupy. Until then, we've got to be busy about the Master's business. Until then, we have to be engaged in what God wants to accomplish. Amen? Amen. But there is coming a day when we will hear the sound, and there will be nothing on this earth that will hold me down. There will be nothing that will keep me here. Amen. Amen. Well, praise the Lord. This is my exit message. Yes, and that's a good thing. It's a good thing in that I want to share out of the depths of my heart and my spirit. I want to empty anything else that's left. In other words, that which I've been carrying, praying, believing, expecting, trusting, crying about, pushing on, I'm going to leave it with you. Leave it in terms of this capacity. So I pray that this afternoon you will not simply hear me. You will not simply hear my voice, but you will hear what God is saying. I earnestly pray that Foursquare Jamaica will hear depths of what I feel the Lord is deposited in me. Amen. Igniting the fire of God. Before I get in the word, there are a few things that I must do. So with your permission, I will. Lady Renee, will you come here? We have been so grateful for the opportunity to have worked, labored in this capacity. We have been truly grateful for what God has done in our lives and that we had the chance to believe God with you, believe God for you, and giving of ourselves to you. Come on, say amen. Yeah, say amen. Even if you don't mean it, say amen. But we want to say that we are honored. We were honored to have served you. I'm going to say it again. There is no way, absolutely no way, that I would have been able to get through 8 years, and it's more, without the prayers, without the support, without the care and nurture. Because there were times when we get done, after you get done, whether it's preaching or organizing or doing whatever or pouring out, and when you get home, this is all after you've gone back to wherever and gone to be with your space, that then I lay back and say, oh, Lord, help me. Or I say, I am tired. And she says, Agar, would you like something to drink? Would you like a cup of tea? So now I drink more tea than I've ever done in my life. Would you like this? Would you like that? And no, and then if you know me, you know I'm very picky about many things, right? So we will go through the list, and you want this? No, I don't want that. You want this? No, I don't want that. You want that? Maybe. And you give me, no, that's not what I did want. That's what. And it took a very special grace. It took a very special grace to have carried me through. And I believe in paying honor where honor is due. And so I want to invite you to do something for me. I probably won't ask you to do anything else for me. I'm going to ask you, though, to stand with me. And for me, not for you. Don't do it for you. Do it for me. I would like you to help me show this woman of God appreciation for her time of service. That's fine. We've practiced how to kiss without everybody seeing it. We've had to master that. But of truth, this has been a time where she has had to sacrifice to and journey, sometimes journeying with me. Because the truth isn't it? I'll tell you, one night I was coming from somewhere. No. So she always wanted to. She thinks I'm too exhausted. She said, may I come with you to drive? I said, no, man, you don't have to come. Don't worry yourself. I'm good. And one night I said, no, I'm not, you know, think you need to come. And she insisted on coming. And believe me, I'm driving back that night, and my eyes began closing. Literally closing. And it was round Junction Road. And she drives, but she don't drive Junction. You know what that means? Well, that night she says, stop the car. Come out. And she jumped right into the car. And she drove us home. Yes. So I want to say to you, Lady Renee, thank you. Thank you for being obedient. Thank you for walking in what God has called you to walk in. When we were getting ready to come to return home, remember we were at dinner with one of our minister friends and came over. And I remember very, very clearly him saying to Renee, as you guys go back home, as you return home, and though it is, was very clear, very, very clear, he says, as you are going home, Gareth is going to do what God is calling to do. He has that. But he said, Renee, I want you to know, you are not going home to be in Gareth's shadow. God has a plan for you and what he was going to do. At that time, she would never even stand before an audience. Would never. We didn't do that. That's not what we do. You know what I mean? We don't do that. But I'm going to tell you that this woman of God has since then spoken locally and internationally. But not just that. What was interesting is there were times that I had to be her armor bearer. Rather than carrying the thing. So can I say to you, because of serving you, our lives are richer. Our lives have been blessed. The more. So, we wanted to thank you for that. And believe me, we're going to miss it. As well as to our children, they have said, Daddy, it's been all of our lives, basically, that you've been in serving in the Foursquare work. That's a very good thing. I'm very proud that my children say that. Because I want them to see godly leadership. Yeah. I want them to see what it was like to walk and carry the ministry and to understand, to give yourself to ministry. And when it was hard and you come home and they see what happens in your life and how you live that. God, that will never leave them. That will never leave them. And so in their heart and in their minds, they too. So on behalf of our family, thank you. Just needed to do that and wanted to say very, very, very much that we appreciate it. And God bless, God bless, God bless. I want to acknowledge here all of our pastors and leaders, district supervisors, and just all of you who have carried the Foursquare work and continue faithfully to carry the Foursquare work. My heart salutes you and salute all of the leaders who have served in different dispensations. I give God thanks for that. I'm particularly pleased that this year we have the Global Associate Director from FMI worshiping with us in our convention and also speaking in our convention, Reverend Aaron Hunter, who is here today. Will you also, those of you who don't know him, there's some who are just coming today. Will you just stand so that they can see? Come on, let's give him a Jamaican welcome. Earlier, thank you, sir, for making it here. And earlier we had the missionaries, but also I mentioned to you earlier that the national leader for Peru's daughter was also here, Natalia. And Natalia is here. She, okay, all right, but she is here. Yes, there you are. Come on, let's make her welcome. Amen. Very, very pleased. Thank you so much, Natalia, for taking the trip all the way from Peru. Listen, before she came here long ago, her father said to me, this was back in 2016, we were at a global, you know, regional summit of sort, southern summit, something of the sort, in Panama. And he said, listen, I want to translate for you. So when you come, come to Peru and I will preach for you. Now, who would have known that years later, the next generation, he hasn't yet translated for me, but look what God would do. His daughter comes to Jamaica and is pouring out even in our midst. Come on, give God thanks for that. It is possible for us to miss the hand of God. It is possible for us to lack a grasp of what God is doing. Why? Because our eyes are on the wrong thing and in the wrong place. It is possible for us to overlook the things and the ways that God is making his move and has been inviting us to be a part of those moves, and we are not able to get with him. Why? Because our eyes are on the wrong thing. I am pleased that the Lord would lead us to this theme, igniting the fire of God. I want you to say that with me, igniting. Now the Lord in you, yes, somebody, the teacher said in you, indeed, igniting the fire of God in you. This theme really calls us to an understanding and particularly how it's impressed upon my spirit, is the Lord is calling us the body of Christ, which is you. Turn to your neighbor and say, he's talking you. Turn to the next neighbor and say, you. Yes, yes, yes. Because sometimes things are being said in church and we think it is the next person and never us. But tonight we're talking every single one who is sitting here this afternoon. The Lord is saying to each of us that there is something that we must do. There is something upon our lives that we must accomplish. There is something that is upon us to be fulfilled. And so, while there are several different definitions for the fire of God, and some of you know it, you have heard it, it's Holy Spirit in one instance, in another instance, it is the fervor and the passion, in another instance, it is that zeal that is being referred to. I want to, for the next few minutes, talk about the fire of God from the perspective of the passion and drive and desire. It is true that some of us, or many of us, have sat year after year and term after term, or season after season, Sunday after Sunday, and we hear words of God coming, and we hear messages, and we hear instruction, and we have felt very good. We have clapped and we have said, yes, amen, God, thank you for that word, and so on. But there are some of us who have yet to respond to the word of God. We are hearing the voice and you're hearing the words that are spoken, but somehow we have not responded. We still come to church because that's what we do. We still show up because that's what we have been counseled to do, but there is no real response, because a response is coming. The response to God only has meaning when it comes from the heart. That's why man looks on the outward appearance, but God sees the— yes, and God is only interested in heart. So even if your lips are saying the right things, because we ask you, repeat after me, and you say this and you go ahead and say that, it means absolutely nothing until your heart is engaged in what God wants. God desires a response from you and from me, and that response must and only can come from the heart. The observation I've made as a minister of the gospel, not just here but in other parts, that there are many of us still waiting on something else to do what God wants us to do. There are many of us still sitting hoping that there is going to be another thing, whatever that thing is, that is going to inform us about our movement. Albeit that God clearly and distinctly tells us what he wants us to do, we are still folded, we are still sitting, we are still relaxed, we are still very composed, we are still very ordinary, we are still very casual, we are still very laid back, and that's why we can't come into the house of the Lord, and the presence of the Lord is really at work. But you sit down in the presence of the Lord, and you sit down and I wonder, when is it going to hit you? So God is stirring hearts and calling hearts and calling all people and having things stirred up in heart. But we are sitting in the midst of that and nothing happens. We are still waiting. How do I know this? Because from one year's instruction to the next, as God would speak to us to a body, nothing changed. You look at the same people doing the same things over and over, doing the same motion, the same operation, and nothing is quite different. And the thought is, Lord, there's got to be more when it comes to a corporate body. Surely God can visit with me and visit up upon me in a private moment, and he does. But there is something when he is mobilizing a group of individuals to achieve a specific purpose. Can I say this? That the church here, not just Foursquare, but specifically as I'm speaking to you, the church Foursquare is here for a purpose. And what that means is, it is not a specific individual who is called to do something, but is a group of people whom God has been trying to mobilize in a particular way and to get them to respond a particular way. But somehow, even after the word of God has been declared and professed, there's no movement. There is no true shift. We get these momentary things, but check us next week. Check us next month. Some of you have enrolled in convention this year. Oh, what a wonderful theme, and I'm hearing it. Oh, wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. But check us next month. And we have lived like that. Well, there is something burning up inside of my spirit. Has been burning inside of my spirit that there has got to be a different flow. There has got to be that we are going to have to speak to a generation, whichever that is going to understand that God is calling for something else than the norm and the regular, something more than just what we do, and that they are going to get it in their spirit and they are going to move upon it. And so my assignment tonight is very, very specific, very, very specific. I try to think that, well, you know, all these wonderful men who have gone before me will take care of it, and I really don't need to speak, but I believe that I'm called to deliver this afternoon. So I look forward to this. I must give honor to those who have gone before, all the wonderful speakers from Friday night, Reverend Aaron. On Sunday morning, there was Reverend Burnett. And then last night, Bishop Dr. Roy Notice. And so then this morning, we had Reverend Nelson. All of these men, I believe, well learned, well studied, and well delivered. They have spoken well. Come on, that's where you put your hands together, yeah? Mm-hmm. And the thing is, when you are the last speaker, as with any program, if all the people who go before you, I hate doing this, I think it must be, I think it's a funeral service or something like that, one of them, that if you are at the end, everybody has said everything that you desire to say. And we say they've stolen the thunder. And so, of course, having thought about that I'm going to be at the end, that they are going to cover, means they're going to wrap up very, very thoroughly. They're going to comprehensively cover all of the ins and the outs of the theme, that by Monday afternoon when I'm getting ready to speak, there'll be nothing left. Every word that I'm going to speak, they're going to say, but the speech of the other night said that, you know. And the preacher the other night said that, you know. Always was a Sunday morning speaker who said that, you know. But do you realize that though that is true, one of the things that I felt the Lord said is that there are two things you need to be aware of. One, there are those who would not have heard even though they were there. It was said, but it missed them. And so it gives you an opportunity to say it. That's one. But two, it is that there are those who were never there. And the reason why these people have to get is, though it's been released in the convention, these people who will show up this day, those who will make their way here, they need to hear very well what is being said. And so I believe without a shadow of a doubt that your design to be here is as my design to stand here. And that as you are sitting there, whatever God has deposited in me is to be said to us tonight. Amen. And so I'm in no fear or apprehension or any worries. I've come to deliver as I've received of the Lord, I will give unto you. Amen. Glory to God. Father, we just pray right now in the name of Jesus that you will help me on tonight. That Jesus, you will cause your Holy Spirit to take full control. Let no flesh, let nothing that I would want to say from my mind be what gets communicated, oh God. And that your voice, the people will hear your heart. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. 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 So going quickly to the text, and I want you to work with me. I told you that I am going to be using the fire of God from the perspective of the passion that is within you. It is this peace, if we were to define the fire of God from a passion perspective, it is this drive that is in you. It is that which causes you to keep going and going and going and going. It is that which, if we think of it in a very natural way, it is that which caused some people to get up every single day and they want to go and they keep running after it and they keep pursuing it. It is this thing that has gotten hold of them. It's this thing that has captivated their thoughts and their mind, and it is propelling them. Are you with me so far? So when I'm saying a passion, I'm talking about when you think of something that every time somebody asks you, what are you thinking about? It is this thing that you talk about. Every opportunity you get to open your mouth and to express something, this thing just seems to come up. Every conversation, you start talking about cars, but before you know it, you're talking about this thing. You're talking about health and your issues, and you just somehow end up coming right back around to this particular thing. That's what we're talking about. We want us to have that passion. You know why? Because many of us are sitting down as though we are dead and dry and chipped, that we are out and so on. There is nothing causing us to move. There is nothing about God's work that has caused us to step forward in one way or the other. How do I know this? The things that preoccupy our minds and our thoughts and our day has nothing to do with the purpose for which God saved us. The thing that we are busy concerning or preoccupying ourselves with or engaging with has nothing to do with what is it that God has for us or desire for us. The many things that perplex our heart, the thing that would wake us up, the thing that would cause us to cry. Have you ever cried where words just can't express what you're feeling, but you just become so overwhelmed? I remember one day in talking about church, I'm just talking about church, and this just happened to me, and I'm talking about church and I'm saying, Lord, why such and such and such and such and such? And as this thing is coming, the next thing I know, I'm falling on my knees. I'm not dropping, I'm not collapsed. Rather, what it is, I'm being brought to my knees and tears flowing out of my heart. There is a passion. Not talking about getting a glimpse of, oh, that's nice, oh, that's wonderful. I'm talking about something that gets you out of your seat and get you moving. There has to be the movement in this season. We must move. Say that to the next person. We've got to move. Yes, there's got to be movement. There's got to be real activity. And whereas we have struggled even as this kind of church, and just by virtue of how we operate, we seem not to touch a group of individuals who are critical to future, and that is the younger generation. Somehow, some way, we are doing lots of things, but somehow these youngsters are slipping us by. These youngs, they're slipping us by. How do I know this? Even in our own house, they're slipping us by. So we're not here talking about fancy conversation. We're talking about real things. We're talking about capturing a generation that has to know God and be about God. And if we don't get this fire soon, we are certainly in trouble. We are certainly in trouble. Can't sit down like everything is all right. Everything is not all right. Everything is not good. I've seen some who have powerful call on their lives in this ministry. Out. No longer on fire. No longer talking about what God is doing. Oh, you've never seen that? Oh, you don't know anybody? I'm the only one who knows somebody who used to be here under fire. Fire, fire, fire. Ooh, and the soul caught fire. And they're under it. And I'm not just merely talking about backsliding, but I'm talking about gone cold, 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 cold. Because the other thing we are about is that we think because they come into the sanctuary that everything is all right. We think because they sit up in there, and when we are saying sing and clap your hands, they sing and clap their hands, then that's all right. They're sitting there and there is no burning in their heart. I can't stand it anymore. I can't stand it anymore. So here is this, and that's where this thing is birthed from. Here is this. We are looking at our text in 2 Timothy. Pull that up for me. 2 Timothy chapter 6. I too, like the other ministers, would like to endorse the theme as God's word to us as a body. Through the global church or the larger body of church, universal church, the church at large in Jamaica. But there is a specific call to the Foursquare church in Jamaica. Yes, I'm convinced of it. I don't need to be president to know that. That won't leave my heart. I leave the office, but that won't leave my heart. To know that there needs to be a burning inside of the people of God who God has called in this congregation, who call around this group of people. There is a sense of lukewarmness among us. There's a sense of ordinary things among us. But I hear God says it's time to stir up that which has been upon us. And so we're going to talk and reason about it and get the record straight and pull out some things. I feel in my spirit as I was preparing that there was some things that we must do even tonight. So I'm permitted and I'm just wanting to flow as I'm sensing in the spirit. Hallelujah, hallelujah. And so let's go to the text. The text says that there is this conversation that is happening between two individuals at this point, that there is a spiritual father, if you will, or there is an older saint, if you will, and he's conversing with, sharing heart, sharing thought, sharing idea, sharing reason, sharing life, sharing moments with a younger believer. In other words, he's writing. Can you imagine this? The older saint, who is, by the way, not free at this point, but we will come to that in a minute. He's not free, but there is a burden on his heart for a younger one. There is somebody he carries in his spirit. There is somebody who matters a lot. There is somebody who, when you read the first part of the text, it says, here's what's happening. My heart literally jumps for joy. I'm literally filled with excitement to the point that I could probably cry. That's what the speaker even said last night. That dear, I can get. Why? Because my mind recalls something about you. What he was doing was affirming something that was true in the life of this younger one. He was celebrating. My God, that's an issue. Oh, that's an issue, particularly in Pentecostal churches, it appears. Because you see, the thing is, we have not learned how to celebrate anybody. Everything is an issue. Everybody else, because we are so struggling with all kinds of instability that we have the inability to just celebrate somebody else. We have a struggle just to see the good. Brother Obed, I am just so blessed by God for the gift that is on your life. When you sit to play, my heart rejoices when you hit those notes and it's well. Sister Antoinette, where are you? She was there. Oh, when you sang that song. Oh, and that wasn't even my favorite song, sister. You know, that wasn't even it. But hear what? When you get to do it, that even when your voice is gone, God has a way of using you. That when I don't hear your voice, my heart misses your voice in the sanctuary. I'm just able to celebrate. I'm just able to identify that which is good, that which is special, that which is up on somebody else's life. Do you know I'm not just focused on what God is doing in me and what he's doing for me and what I need him to do? I can literally take these moments and I will consider somebody else. And I have the ability to call out over that person's life for two reasons. One is I'm old enough. I know you don't think so. I may soon address that. But I am old enough to recognize when something good is going on for you. Oh, Oh my God. I surely don't know everything. I surely don't know quite everything. But what I'm able to do is to lift up somebody else's hand. So Paul, who now is in prison, is thinking, should be perplexed in his spirit, right? No, should be bothered in his spirit because he's imprisoned. And surely, maybe he should be sending a prayer request because he's in prison. But here he writes out of this place to a young soul. Why? Because he understands that if Timothy doesn't get it, if Timothy doesn't understand what this walk is about, if he doesn't understand what God is trying to do in him, through him, and what this journey of faith is about, then Timothy may get lost. Timothy could get off track. Timothy could miss his step. A thing that is happening to the body of Christ today. There are many missteps taking place. And those who are able to see and to nourish and to call forth, we're not spending the time to come. So pardon me, my children, not Uno, my biological children. I'm asking them pardon because I'm going to have to use them as examples. So I'm seeking their permission, even though I'm not waiting for an answer, so that I can talk about some things about them. No, the truth is, there are some things that I see in my son, Carrington, that sometimes is an issue for me. No, it's not sometimes, it's all the time. All the time. You see, because in my head, I've already mastered out every step that he must make, you know. You don't understand what I'm saying? No. You don't understand. As his father, I have already a full program. I know he must make this step because it's this step he must make. So I want to always tell him, don't put your foot there, put it over here. As I look on, I may discover him not doing the steps like I would like him to do it. At that moment, I have a choice. I either kill him, and in Jamaica, that sometimes means literal, don't it? You pray for us here. Or I find a way to help him to think differently. Can I tell you the way I am? Is that after I have told you the first time, because I grew up in an era that one word was sufficient. Having been raised under the one word regime that says, as you speak it, so it shall be. When dealing with him, you know how we have this move, name it and claim it? Or you just go in and speak it and declare it and it happens? Well, it's some mean run it here. I speak it, it happens. You know, like when God came to the earth and him does scarlet things them and they move. But then I have to start realizing and recognizing that I can't quite manage all of his steps. I mean, I desperately want to manage all of his steps. And at best, what I can do for him is simply give him some guidelines. At best, I mean, it's the hardest thing to accept. I struggle. I'm talking, you want a prayer item? You pray for me. Because I struggle to think that the one word order won't work. Because as far as I can remember, it did work for me. And so I become very intolerant and impatient when the one word not working. But I've come to the place to understand that I either choose to provide him the guidance, because it's only so long I'm going to have him around me anyway. It's only so long that he's going to go, Daddy, what did you say? Because at a certain point, he's going to be gone. At a certain point, he's going to get to the age where he's going to say, well, this is what I'm going to do. And I am hoping, desperately hoping, that what I would have done is, knowing that day is fast approaching, is I am going to now forget myself, because I think I've got it right. I have to set myself aside and say, you know, I need to give him guidelines so that when I'm not there, he will remember. Oh, remember what your father said. Remember what your father said. Remember what the word said. Remember, you're at best the time, so I can either stay there and fight him to do what I say, or I can lay him a blueprint that hopefully when he gets on his own, he will go, I'm gonna go check on what my father told me. So Paul in prison, thinking about this bright young man, thinking about this bright youngster who is brilliant with all this opportunity and all this grace, why he sees this very powerful thing all over him and all upon him. And so now he sets pen to paper and he sets out to encourage Timothy. And he looks at Timothy and says, listen, I see something upon you. Talking about the conversation that is happening between two generations, a conversation that is happening between an older saint, so because he's calling for something. Then he says, listen, hey, Timothy, I rejoice over you. My heart celebrates because when I think of you and I see, and you know what? I'm minded to point out some good things for you. And he says, you see that faith that you have? This faith, if Timothy didn't know it, this faith, I recognize it, because it was first in your grandmother, it was first, then next in your mother, and I'm absolutely sure. Here is what's going on. We are recognizing that when we fix certain things now, it is going to affect several generations down the road. If we get this thing moving among us, the generations that will come later will be set on the way. Or the generation that will come later will not know the God that we're talking about. So he continues and he says to him, hear what? There is something in you. There is something that I already know is in you. This I am sure of because I lay hands. We as the church have not been laying hands on our younger generation and calling forth the giftings and the calling of God. We have not done so. We have not spoken over. Can I tell you something? This was just a little revelation I got. So I thank God where it came from. I knew that before those children were born, that I had to pray over them and call for purpose and destiny. So thank God, here's what would happen. Every night in them, mother womb, me take oil and me pray over, rub the oil on, and I spoke forth. It didn't stop while they were in the womb. As they come out, here is this. I'm teaching them not from at home. I'm teaching them not from early. We are going to speak over you. Now they are in our churches, and we have not yet spoken over. Their youngsters here have no idea of direction, and we as spiritual leaders have not yet. So we can't write like Paul, who says, I know this is in you because you got it when I gave it to you, when my hand rested upon you. When I laid my hands, the gift came in. Understand this. So Paul, come with me a little bit. So Paul jumps back out of it. And Paul points out that, listen, there's a calling that I was called and appointed to the office of apostle and teacher and so on to the Gentiles. That is the same thing that is connected to knowing that there is something in you. Here's the connection I'm making for you. Every single one of us, when we came to the Lord and so on, and even from before we were born, I will tell you this, because Jeremiah tells us that God was so involved in the process of forming us that there was a purpose. There was a purpose between the time of getting the purpose and living through. There are many things that are at stake, so much so that there are people who are fighting to fulfill the purpose of their on their lives. They are sitting down in your church right now, right here, right today, and they are not walking in purpose. They neither know it, neither are we pointing them to the purpose. So here is this now. So Paul wants Timothy to understand this. The thing that is in you that is going to come under much pressure, they are going to come under and face many obstacles. You are going to come under opposition. I want to tell you something now, even while I'm in prison, to help you out, because you're going to need this pretty soon. And he says to him, understand this. God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and the sound mind. So this becomes the answer and the solution. Here is this. I was thinking the other day, just as I was thinking, you don't know this about me, so I'm gonna just share it. Don't tell anybody else. I have learned that in order to overcome both the lies of the devil, the discouragement by the enemy, or the deception that could be, that I had to learn how to praise the Lord. I had to learn how to keep my spirit up when everything else is pointing down. I had to learn that in hard times, I had to be able to keep on going. So hear this now, just a little bit of thing here. There is a thing, when the children were a little younger than they are now, I used to put on a certain kind of music at home. This is not church, so I'm not dressed like church. I'm dressed like my damn yard. So in my yard apparel, which none of you could ever see, you understand what I'm saying? But you me there, me yard? Me good. But what would happen is, almost what I thought was innocently done, I would get music on and do my dance. Truly. So you get a good look of music and me just start dance. And the children, as little as they were, they would just. So I am putting up. Come, could you help me? Could you help me? Please help me. I want you to understand a principle here. Because you see, when we're talking about preparing the next generation, you have to prepare them long before they catch up there now. So here now. So I would just be doing it because it's my thing to do, right? And I just put on my music and I just start dancing. One day we had a couple's, we were part of a couple's ministry when we were in Minnesota. And they one night put it on. And then little Carrington, no. Then little Carrington started this. And they were largely African Americans. So of course they were like, oh, hey! And Carrington kept on going. All right. So we come home. Little bit, you know, them the time, them about three or four or something like that. So a little bit. So you know, take it to mean nothing really, right? But now, come on, man, and every time them see me, believe me, they will know it, especially if me get a good news. Me just need something for go good. And me just put on my music. Where you go? Sit down for me. Sit down. Take a seat. Me just put on my music. I'm just praise, I remember. Oh, I've got a feeling, hey, that everything is gonna be all right. Daddy, what's wrong with you? Can't tell you no. Got a feeling everything is gonna be all right, hey. And I just keep going, kept on going, and they're watching. So them don't really know the story, but after a while, them just. And then carry on. All right, so now, me a big smaddy. Me not having the kind of energy that like when me did young. When I was younger, right? But every single day, this boy turn on the music in the house. We want getting at the bathroom, him at the bathroom and the music I go. Him down in the kitchen, he's in the kitchen and he's trying to get ready for school and the music is going on in his ears and stuff. Sometimes him don't notice, you know. So you're just walking by the room and you just catch him and you see him inside there. I'm gonna sit down there. When I came to my senses, I said to him, why stop your foolishness now? You think we can sit on, you think we can go on every single day, just jumping and carrying on? And it struck me this morning that he might get up in an age, he's getting older. He is maturing and soon he might not be under my direct influence. And I know, having journeyed myself, that life came with some rough things. That life showed up in ways when there was nobody around church. I wasn't there at church. I didn't have the saints who always nurtured and prayed for me. But then what happened for me is that when things got real bad, I could go in the room, I could shut the door, and all I could do is... So in my spirit, the Lord says, you have taught him how to overcome every struggle. You have taught him that when he cannot express, he can come into my presence and he can dance. And while you think he was faking it to make it, while you think he was rehearsing some silly thing, you have deposited in him that when things aren't going right, you can get to praising God. Because he's going to need it. It's not if he's going to need it. He's going to need it. You know how I know? Because something in him. I know it because I was there. There's a call on his life. His uncle said, years ago, visited with his uncle and family. And apparently in their devotional time, grandmother was there. He is guiding them. He would have been probably 5, 6, 7. And he's calling. My brother says to me, boy, he wants to carry on. He's a natural leader, you know. He's a natural leader. So even others can see it. You think the devil going to sit down and wait upon this gift of leadership that is in him from him born? Yeah, that this thing that we know that is true. You think the devil isn't going to come to try and derail him? You don't think the devil is going to try and tell him, no, don't go that way, go this way. No, don't love the Lord anymore, try this thing. He's got to be prepared. I've got to get a fire in him. And the fire is not but it's because the fire is in his responses. Let me shout. The shouting is not the fire. It is the knowledge that God, you are my refuge and my strength, a very present help in time of trouble. When my little one, baby, Kenny, you're not left out, your stories won't come up. The baby, I told him that I want them to sit down and know, because this is important to me. He said, no, get this. If the congregation doesn't understand what I'm saying, I need these three children to understand. And I wanted them to get it when the Lord anoints me to speak it right here, right now. I don't want to have to summarize it later. I want them to get it good as the Holy Spirit is using me to deliver it to the congregation. So I told them, I don't want any movement during this time. I want you to sit down and hear me. Because what I'm speaking about is this destiny and future. And I need you to understand these things. Yeah, we're not going to joke around this thing, because I cannot afford to sit by and you go north and south and walk away from God. I cannot afford for you to miss the timing of God. I can't afford for your life to go the left or south. So I want to spend the time, it's probably saying, help them to understand how to fan the flame. So here it is, as I wrap. He goes in to sing, and I want seven persons, male, females, I want it to come. So this passion that is, he's telling him, flame that passion. Let that passion come forth. Because there are things that will stifle out that passion. They start ready to go. Stamorant is right there. Mean, you see this door here? Prayer meeting Monday night, Wednesday night, we are here. There are others who were with us, not here. The fire's gone, right? So we need them to have a strategy. I can't wait until they get to our age to figure that out, because they have to get over it now. At school, secularism is telling them that they don't need God. They're already teaching them in religious education that Christ and Jesus is just one option and you don't have to choose him. If I don't get them settled in their mind, the devil is going to try and tell them, here's an alternative way to living your life. So we've got to get that flame going. We've got to get that flame going. Let me say this right quick. There are some people who know already that there is this powerful call upon their life, but there is a constant struggle to work it. Where are my seven options? I need seven persons to come with me. And while they're doing that, come. While they're doing that, will you put up for me Romans chapter 8? So this is Paul again. Remember, here is this. There are times, like Paul wasn't in the original lineup of disciples. Are you hearing me? Paul wasn't in the original lineup of the apostles. In fact, he was not in the pipeline. He didn't walk physically with Jesus when Jesus was here on the earth. In other words, he was an oblivion. In other words, he was on a path that not even Christians want him and them to mingle. Are you understanding what I'm saying? But from the foundation of the earth, there was something in Paul. And the devil wanted to use Paul against the very church. But then God met him, eh? God met him. And what do we have today? The something that was in him, the gift of the ministry that was in him, now has impacted churches all over the world. It is what we are living by. It is he who says that God has not given you the spirit of fear, but of power, love, and of a sound mind. It is he who did. The thing that is in, don't you understand? The devil is after what is inside of you. No, I'm gonna say that again. The devil is inside of what is on your life. The reason why some of us will sit down in church unactivated is because we don't have that flame going. Gareth, no, come up here, sir. Don't have the flame going. The thing, I needed to get this. So as they come up, let me not let them distract you, because this is one of the points of emphasis that I have. I'm glad I get various age groups. These are some teenagers. These are your teenagers, also? Of course. At the day of this generation, this. No, so? Mm-hmm. And these are another generation, and we know who you are, and we know who you are. Yes? Different generation. So I soon deal with them. But understand this. There is something in this man that from his birth marks destiny. And devil has been trying hard. If he ever actually opens his mouth and tell you his story, you would understand that the devil has been trying to kill him and his destiny a long time ago. There is something in this young man. Young lady, I want you to hear me. That if you've never heard another man of God, I'm going to call it over you. There is purpose inside of you. There is something extra special that God has inside of you. Young lady, I want to tell you too that God, our Heavenly Father, has deposited something in you that the devil wants to root up out of you. The same is true for all of you. Something in you, something is in you, something is in you. Here is this. Here, he starts early. The devil tries to start very early to make sure that these youngsters don't get to this man's age. Because by this time, he has fought some battles. By this time, he's overcome some devils. He now understands that right now, it's a little bit too late. It's a little bit too late. In fact, it's absolutely too late. Because he's already been knocked down, trampled on, gone back and forth into mess, and God shake him off and bring him through. But it took a lot of going. If he walked in obedience from early, he would have been spared some of that drama. That's precisely why we must catch them here. That's why we must have them understand it right here. That this generation needs to get this now. Because if this little girl gets to understand how to fight devils, how to drive out demons, how to rebuke the hand of the enemy, how to reverse, then when they get up to here, we have no problems. They are slaying giants left, right, and center. And that's what we want. Amen? Are we together on that? The fire burning. But here is this. Come here. And I'm soon done. Paul, in his talk about what happens to him in Romans. And in Romans, he tells us, Romans 8. And he tells us this about the love of God. You're not going to turn your back. Right, there you go. There you are. Yeah? He tells us about the love of God. What was told to us in the book? God has not given us the spirit of? But power and of love. I am telling you that the love is what I'm calling passion here. The drive, the love, love for God. Love. I want to do. I have this call that is on my life. I've discovered, I recognize it. But for some reason, I just don't want to do it. I just can't be bothered anymore going somewhere. Because there are those who have a clear sense of what is on their life. But many things are going on. Go on down for me. Go on down. Go to the next verse. The next one. The next one. The other one. The next one. Hey, here is the verse. It is 35. So call is on our lives. Are you with me? I understand who I am in the Lord, or I've got some revelation. I've got something that is now upon me, and I've been working and so on and so on and so on. But along, because the enemy is constantly trying to get you out of doing what God would have you do and that which is on your life. Paul says this love, this drive, remember we defined the love as the passion? Yes, this love for God came up. Paul says, what happens? Give me message version. Give me the message version. So let's say this is my first, yeah, change, you have message down there? You don't have message, oh Lord. I like how message translation does it. Ooh. Let me tell you. Here's the reason why I like message translation. It uses terminologies that we can relate to in everyday life. So I wanted to use that. Here goes. So that's Romans 8, verse 35. Okay. This is going slow. We have to pray for speed. But here it is that this thing. So I'm on my way and I'm growing in my understanding and I'm growing in my walk, perhaps with the Lord, and I'm making my move. But hear what? On this journey, here comes trouble. So the Message Bible say trouble. So in my life, I find myself in spots that I should not be in. I'm moving along, but here comes something that is unexpected. And now I'm in trouble. Maybe you have never been in trouble. No, maybe you have never gone into something that you shouldn't have, and now it's blown up on you, and now it's caused a problem. So now you are stuck by trouble, and the enemy is trying to tell you, you can't go any further. Stop. Let go, don't bother, give it up, because you can't do it. Well, you seem to move by trouble, and you're moving along again. But here you get stopped one more time in your track because hard time comes. And trouble probably wouldn't stop you because maybe you had a little word from somebody that encouraged you through the trouble. The hard time is pressing you out because every time you turn around, there is a lack, there's a deficiency, and there's an emptiness. You cannot meet your basic. You cannot seem to find what you really need. There's just hard times on every hand. And yes, you want to do what the Lord wants you to do. You want to go where the Lord wants to go, but times are yes, money, rough. You know what hard times? I mean, I thought more of you understood hard times, but I understand hard times. I remember, you might not think this was anything. When I was in college, I had 5 cookies. I used to buy a carton of macaroon cookies. And each slot has about 5 cookies in it. And I used to wrap up the 5 cookies, because the money I had couldn't buy anything else. So I did that, and I would take one of the, what a juice, you know, Capricorn type juice. So I would have a Capricorn and 5 juice in college, but going to eat for lunch, 5 macaron and a thing. When my lunchtime come, I just go in my bag, take up my 5 macaron and go ahead and eat that. We're talking about hard times. And some of us know even harder times. So it stuck you here, so when you can't seem to make it anymore. But then you might pray and somehow you manage to overcome the hard times. But here comes, and this is the one that's gonna bold you, it's hatred. And you know what? Hatred came in the church. It was okay while it was in the community and it was your neighbor, but then it didn't expect it to happen on the choir. No, you didn't expect it to happen in the praise team. And whoa, you didn't expect it in the prayer group. But then here you are trying to pray your way through, and then you know that hatred has come. Help us, Lord, help us. So you get stuck. No, you're even on your knees. Because you're thinking, surely God, I can't make it. But by God's grace, By God's grace, you overcome. And then here comes another thing. You thought you had missed this one because you've already been through hard times. You already know what it is to wear one pair of shoe or no shoe at all. You already know what it is to have one meal a day and so on. But here you are back on your face in hunger. Because even though you're trying, you can't get any food. And the saints of the living God are not able to help and assist. Because you've made a request, but you get nothing. And why then should I serve God if I'm going to be hungry? Why? No, why then should I even follow and do what God is calling me to do if I'm going to be hungry? No. If I can't get food, then why should I bother with any of this? Maybe you move on from that. And then they kick you out of the house. Then you have nowhere to sleep. Then you're out in the cold. No, we in church can still sing because we're not yet living in on the bloodshed. I walk around in this city sometimes and see people leaning upon the wall going to sleep. Why? And by their feet or their legs are bags and bags. Why? Because they are now homeless. Do you know that is not mad them man make them homeless? It's hard times of life get real bad. And they fall on into this thing. Not bullying. Speaking bad. You know what is bullying? Bullying is where somebody, another person, is trying to control you by what they say and what they do. And they're trying to manipulate you by what they do. That's bullying. But here comes the big one. It's called the backstabbing. According to Message. Oh, you say you don't have it there. The backstabbing. So you're working hard for the Lord. You think you're doing your best. You think you're offering what God has deposited in you. But little did you know that the smile that you just received as soon as you turned your back became not just a frown, but an act of backstabbing. You probably could live through the hunger. You probably could live through the homelessness. But you just can't seem to get through the backstabbing. No. I can't seem to overcome this at all. And so the enemy holds you into a locked place. You can neither go nor come. You try to be free, but you can't because the backstabbing is real. The backstabbing is real and it hurt. Oh. But I hear Paul says, which of these will stop you from having that drive for God? Which of these will prevent you from carrying on? And can I tell you, the body of Christ is plagued with many of these now. And we have believers who are going, well, that's it. That's it. No more. I'm not going any further. I'm not doing anything else. I'm not going to do any more for God. So the call is inside of you, bubbling up inside of you. Thank you so much. Bubbling up inside of you. But here comes these things that's preventing you from coming. We are talking about if you make it through. I need to prepare this next generation who will come upon all of these so that the devil will not be able to derail them. I need to see and believe that God is going to preserve them and he's going to help them because it's not if it's coming, it's when it comes. If you've lived long enough in the body of Christ, you have experienced at least six of those. But not even that, according to Paul, should separate us from that love, that drive, that desire to do all that God wants. Not even that should be adequate. How many of you are sitting down with a gift and a talent that God has given you, not doing anything? Why? Because of something somebody did or something somebody said. Can I tell you that as long as you say yes to the Lord, it is going to... So the devil will stop you in your track so that you will no longer burn by doing what God wants. You will no longer have the passion, and rather what you will do is walk away. What you will do is throw your hand up. Now, some of us have been victim of that, and you may or may not have overcome. We want to deal with that this evening. But then there are others who haven't encountered any of that yet, and especially the young. We want to make sure we lay hands upon. So as part of what the Lord shared with me is that we are to anoint, lay hands upon so that it stirs, so that there is a helping of fanning of the flame in the lives of our people, in the lives of our people who are at the point of struggle, who are about giving up because of all of these issues that have come upon their life. The moment they say yes to the Lord, the moment they say I will to the Lord, is like a floodgate open of challenge. And we are going to awaken this afternoon some heart, some spirit. We are going to astir. We are going to help to keep ablaze those hearts that are on the trouble, those hearts that are being perplexed. And so I would like us at this point, as I close, quickly wrap up here, that as we close, that those who are in that place where your fire is gone and your fire is your passion, you know that there is this call upon you, you know that there is this gifting inside of you, but you also know you have been under strong opposition, you also know you have been up on some strong barriers, you also know that there are some things that have discouraged you, you also know that there are some things that have hindered you, you also know that there are some things that have been preventing you. Hear me, we've got to keep going. Say that to the person next to you. We've got to keep going. There are people right around us who need the gift. Here is this, the gift that you have, the talent you have, according to chapter verse 12 in the same 2 Timothy chapter 1. It says there very clearly that what this thing that is inside of us is about is what Jesus Christ has done. Every gift that you have must speak the gospel of Jesus. The giftings we've got, the thing that is in us, is not to make us popular. The thing that is inside of us is not to give us a name. The thing that is inside of us is not to give us status. Because there's some of us, the minute somebody doesn't say thank you, it was the last time you were doing anything for the Lord. The minute somebody didn't call your name, you are nobody ready to do anything for the Lord. Oh, we can't go in any further like this. We can't go to the next level like that. Because you know what? There are going to be people who never bother to say thanks. You are going to work your heart out and nobody cares. You are going to do your best and all people see is everything bad. You are going to give of your all and all people will ever do is speak poorly about you. Hear this. Get with it. Our fire needs to get up. Neither criticism nor scandal, nothing shall prevent me from moving forward with what God has called me. What he has placed on my life, I will press towards. I'm going to press on, carry it forward. I'm going to do it when nobody knows. I'm going to do it when nobody cares. I'm going to do it when nobody thinks it is going. I don't care how many times they've overlooked me. I don't care how many times they have disregarded me. I don't care what happens. I'm going to go, you know why? Because the fire of God is real on the inside. The fire of God is causing me and compelling me to move forward. We've got to get that fire. I've got to keep going. Touch the person. I've got to keep going. Come on, I've got to keep going. I'm not hearing you. I've got to keep going. Mebo shara mande kura basata. And so this evening, as we close, we are going to stir, fan a flame, some bits. Yeah, yeah, yeah. We are going to help somebody's spirit to be lifted this afternoon. We're going to help somebody's spirit to come alive again. Why? Because the dumps from the enemy, the dirt, or the green wood, that's what I've been hearing, the green bushes, or the dirt is covering it and is causing me to wane. Come on, we want to make sure we press together. You are not alone. Can I tell you this? If you feel discouraged right now, you are not alone. If you feel like giving up, you are not alone. If you feel forsaken, you are not alone. If you feel church has been ungrateful, you are not alone. You ask anybody here, they'll tell you the same thing. Oh, they don't care for me. They don't think about me. They're not kind to me. They say bad things about me. There's a song that says, I've been lied on, cheated, talked about, mistreated. It doesn't matter what it is. It happens. It happens to you. It's going to happen to me. It's only a matter of time. But we all have to keep going. We all have to keep the fire burning. And that's why God is calling us this convention. May I invite you to stand. May I invite you to stand. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Glory, 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 glory. Oh, thank you, Jesus. That God is not wrong. That God is not off in terms of what he's speaking. That indeed he's speaking to a brother and a sister who might be just at the point where they've had enough. Come on, I've had enough. I've had enough, and I feel like I can't go any further. But we are here tonight. Together, we're gonna live through. Together, we're gonna press through. Amen. 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 Don't leave this convention without getting yours. Don't leave this convention. I heard, not just this morning, but at other times, it has been said that there are some of us who believe that we have to come up. And some other pastor, leader, apostle, whomever, is the one who has to do something for us to get our breakthrough. In other words, you have no idea what it is to stir up fire when there is not a congregation around you. You have no idea how to get in God's presence because an apostle is not standing over you. Or the pastor is not, or the deacon, whomever. This evening, I want the generation that knows that though they are not there, I am pressing in. I am going to intensify my press because God is able to come in and stir this fire. So you're going to learn today how we stir. So you are not coming here because I'm going to lay hands upon you and stir up for you. Rather, we are going to activate you to start stirring. Why? Because tomorrow is coming. Next week is gonna be here, and we need to ensure that when we get to the end of the year, that fire of God is burning. Foursquare people are burning for God. So we're gonna go open up the altar. Those of you who know that you need activation. You know that you need someone to come alongside you. And as I said, you're coming with your own heart to open. You're going to learn how to open your mouth. You're going to learn how to start crying out to God for yourself. You're going to learn how you need to press in. You're going to learn to say, God, I've been in many lines now. I've been many times up. But God, right this moment, I need what that which is going to carry me. I need that which is going to keep me. That Jesus, every minute, every moment, that I'm going to get it. I am going to just press. I'm going to learn how to open my mouth. I'm going to learn how to lift up my voice. I'm going to learn how to lift up my hands. I'm going to learn how to receive from God. I'm going to learn how to call forth from God that which he has in store for me. And so we are going to lay hands in the name of Jesus. And we are going to believe God this afternoon that God is going to be stirring hearts and lives in here. Is that amen? Amen. Yeah, sound like I'm not sure. I feel like I may have to go this alone. Do I have witnesses here who are standing with me, who are already praying? They are already praying for people who are coming. They are already praying that people are going to step on. Praise and worship team, you have to be up already. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, I've been dry for a long time. I have gone cold because there has been nothing going on. I have been trying to touch heaven, but I'm not getting through. I feel like I'm not getting through, but I'm going to press today. I'm going to press today. I'm going to press today. Don't watch. Believers already start praying. Those who pray in the spirit, go ahead and pray. Let's set an atmosphere that's going to help somebody, that's going to bring somebody through. Rabaka sanda bakasata. Reboko shanda bakasata. Ribandoro boku yandoro lobo shanda. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I pray, Lord God, that those who are coming, that there will be no fear. There will be nothing that is hindering those who need to come. Let them move it, oh God, because we must change. We must change. Those who are standing must change. They've got to make it to the next level, God. They've got to go to the next place, God. They've got to get their breakthrough. I need some intercessors to already stir the hand of God. Some intercessors, lift your voices. Intercessors, lift your voices. Come on, it matters for somebody. It matters for somebody. Roboko shabani wakasaya. Yeboko sibandele lebokoshi. Father, we call upon you. Lord, we call upon you. Lord, we call upon you. Holy Ghost, we call upon you. Oh, don't stand at the altar and look. Close your eyes already. Lift your hands already. Come on, you don't receive anything with hands down. Lift your hands already. Have a posture that says, God, here I am, vessel. Open those hands. Open those hands. Yes, yes, yes. Lord, fill me. Lord, fill me. Lord, fill me. Rabakas and Baba Babakia. Ribando Robokoshat. Robokoshapandeba. Come on, I'm not hearing anything at the altar. Every mouth open. Jesus, 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 I press. Anoint for me. Anoint. Come on, it's gonna happen here today. God promises that it's gonna happen. God promised. Come on, intercessors, lift up your voices. Come on, ministers, don't stand. Help. Somebody need help. Come, ministers of the gospel, get in position. You don't even have to touch them, but I want you to surround them. Come on. Yes, Holy Ghost. Yes, Holy Ghost. Come on, let him do it. Open your mouth, baby. Open your mouth. Say something to Jesus. Come on, say something to Jesus. Jesus, I love you. Come on, don't be afraid. Jesus, I love you. Oh, God. I look to you. I'm young, but I look to you. God, I want you to touch me. God, I want you to touch me. I want you to touch me. Yes. Yes. Yes, little one. Cry out to God. Come on. God wants to stir that fire. God wants to stir that fire. God wants to stir that fire. Oh. God wants to stir that fire. God wants to stir that fire. Ba 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 kosata. Ba 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 kasata. Ba 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 kosata. Ra ba 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 kasibondo boshata. Ye ba kasata ba. Come on, we are getting through. Ra ba kasata ba 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 ba. Oh, woman of God, woman of God, woman of God. Ye ba 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 kasata ba here. Ye ba 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 ba. I stand with you, woman of God. I stand with you. Kebo shata. Ye ba 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 kasata. Ye ba 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 kasata. Rokoto boshiba. Rabakasata ndobokosha. Ye ba 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 kasata. Robokoshata. Robokosia. Robokosia ndaba. Ye ba kasando bokoshata. Rebokoshada ba 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 no. Come on, seek him. Come on, say, Jesus, you gotta do it for me. Jesus, fill my cup. Fill my cup, oh God. words flow. Come on, let words flow. Jesus, do something for me, God. 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 Do something for me. Do something for me. The blood of Jesus. Oh, break through, God. Break through, break through, break through. Baba Zata. Rokoto Moshiana. Baba Baba Kasanda Bakaya Yeketebo Shanda Ramaha Roboko Shanda Bakaya. Yes, let him do it. Let him do it. Baba Baba Kashata Yokoto Baba 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 Shandele Bosha Siba Baba 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 Kasha Roboko Shaba Baba 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 Reboko shata baba baba chata yekete bo shanda yokoto no mane baba 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 ye baba 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 kasata reboko shata fill our God in the name oh stir from within makaboro ye baba kasata baba baba put it down on their head oh baba 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 kasata reboko shata baba baba kasata Rebecca Sata Baba Reboko Shata, come on. Come on, come on. Come on, come on, come on. Help, help, help. Help, 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 help. Help, 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 help. Baka Shapa Baba Baba Shata. Yobobo Shata Baba Bakas. Reboko Shapa Baba. Yes, God, by your spirit. 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 By your spirit, by your spirit, by your spirit, your bobo boko shata, roboko baba baba shanda, yeko tobo shana na mande, roboko shata baba bakande, roboko shibandaya, yeko tona mande, roboko shana mande yo, siba handolo boshi, yeba hande boko shata, yeba baka sando, Jesus. Jesus, we call you. Jesus, we call you. Jesus, we believe you. Jesus, we trust you. Makata Robo Shata. Rebako Robo Shana.
Holy Ghost.
Ibo Shata. Yeah, anointing of the living God. Ebo Shata. Eboko Shata. Ebaku Robo Shana. Yoboko Shana Baba Baba Kasata. Eboko Shaka Baba Baba Kosata. Yeboko Shana Bakasiando Lobo. Yes, boy, open your mouth. Come on, open your mouth, open your mouth. Say something to the Lord. Say something to the Lord. Come on. Say something to the Lord. Father, in the name of Jesus. Oh God, touch him. Touch him, touch him. Touch him, touch him, touch him. Touch him, touch him, touch him, touch him. Ebakasata. Yes, 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 yes. Come on, young man. Yeah, will you lift up your hands? Come on, you want to receive from him, lift up your hands. And lift up your voice. Come on, open those mouths. Oh, forget the singing. Start saying something to the Lord. Come on, start praying to the Lord. Lord, I love you. Lord, I look to you. God, you got to touch me. God, you got to touch me. Lord, I desire you to touch me. Jesus, I need you. Jesus, I need you. Jesus, I need you. Come on. Come on. Pour out your heart to him. Pour out your heart. Pour out your heart. Come on, sister. Pour out your heart. Lift up your voice. Lift up your voice. Lift up your voice. Yes, Jesus.
Lord, yes.
Yeah, Bakata. Yeah, Bakashata. Roboko Shata.
Shabbat neighbor. Yes. Yes. Akatabashan. Akatoroboshan. Reboko shanda bandido.
To somewhere else, but he had to stop because he had a need.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
The ministers led him to the Lord right outside. Come on, let's give God praise. Come on, let's give God praise. But he still has a special need. He still has a special need. And we believe that Jesus meets the needs of people. He certainly meets the need of young men. Amen, brothers. Hallelujah. Are you able to say? God can deliver you.
Yes.
And when we say deliver you, it's to take your life, turn it around.
Yeah.
So that you do what he wants. Yes? There you go. I'm going to ask you, those of you who are not currently, don't be stopped by us. Those of you who still need to press on in, continue to press. But this brother, we're asking God for a special deliverance.
Yes.
We're asking God to turn his life around. We're asking God to elevate him and make him a man of God who will do kingdom business, that he be placed on kingdom assignment.
Hallelujah.
And that his life will never be his own. Yeah? Do we have agreement in the house today? All right. So come on, let's pray as the Spirit of the Lord is here. Come on, brothers, let's lift up our voices on behalf of this man. Father, in the name of Jesus, here comes a man like you met that woman at the well. You met this man on the outside. You turned his direction inside. Now he's asking for a special touch. Is there anything too hard for you, God? Is there anything too hard for you, God? You specialize in impossible circumstances. You consider the ways of our deeds. And God, you help us. You make our lives better. Now, God, we stand on behalf of this man. We say, God, he must not be the same. I pray, God, you will help Kevin Campbell by name. We call him by name. Kevin, we speak to you. In the authority of Jesus Christ, we plug you out of the wall of the enemy. We bring release to your life. We say, be set free, be delivered. Come on, come on. Ebo shata bandebush. Be delivered in Jesus' name. Be delivered in Jesus' name. Every stronghold be broken. Every stronghold be broken by the power of the Holy Spirit. You will not continue to walk according to your own flesh and your own desire. Holy Spirit, ambush him right now. Hey, God, arrest him right now. Every thought, God, I pray that you will hold him. Let him not slip away. Let him not be able to slip away. Oh, we claim him in the name of Jesus. Lord, we ask you to put your mark upon him. In the name of Jesus. Come on, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of. In the name of. Thank you, Jesus. We rebuke every stronghold. We rebuke every chain. Be broken now. Be set free. Your troubled mind, be at peace. Your trouble, I speak to your mind right now. I speak to every issue in your life. I speak to every trouble in your life. God, deliver him. Lift up this other hand to him. Yeah. Lift him up to Jesus. Hold him up. Lord God, I pray that he'll be fully surrendered. Let this be a Saul becoming a Paul.
Hallelujah.
In the name of Jesus. God, we pray that you will cleanse him from the inward part. Cleanse him from the inside. Oh, God, come on, brothers. Let's cleanse him from the inside. Let his life never be the same. Let him never be the same. Give him a new mind.
New body, Lord.
Give him a new heart.
New heart, Jesus.
In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Be loose, Kevin. Be loose, Kevin. Be loose, Kevin. In the authority of Jesus Christ, be loose from all stronghold, from all bondage, from all conditions of your past life, from all ways that you used to walk. Oh God, deliver him tonight. Deliver him tonight. Deliverance tonight. Kotoro bashanda bakasata. Reboko shanda bakasibo hoshata. Reboko shandi nibiko shata bandela lebo shata. Be delivered. Be delivered. Be delivered. Be delivered. Be delivered. I'm free. Hold up your head, Kevin. Say, I'm free. God, you set me free. Thank you for setting 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 me free. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Come on. Two more minutes. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh. Oh. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, put your hands together. Don't be distracted. Don't be distracted. Don't be distracted. Come on, lift him up. Lift Jesus up. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, he said, if I be lifted up, be delivered. Be delivered. Be delivered. Be delivered. Be delivered. Be delivered. Peace of God. Peace of God. Yeah, peace of God. Peace of God. Set you completely free. Completely free. Come on, everybody. Let's look to Jesus. Come on, let's lift up Jesus. Let's lift up Jesus. Let's lift up Jesus. Take her to the back. Take her to the back. Take her to the back. You can take her to the back and finish with her by then. Come on. Go with her. You have the authority. Come on. Carry her. And finish her up by there. Come on. Be set free. Be set free. He's here to deliver you. Be gone in Jesus' name. Be loose in Jesus' name. We drive you out in the name of Jesus. And the peace of God rests. The peace of God rests. Hold it. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for victory. Oh, thank you for victory. Thank you, Jesus.
In the name.
Let's do. Victory is mine.
Victory is mine. Victory is mine. Victory today is mine. I told Satan to get thee behind.
Okay, you gotta stop.
Victory.
You gotta be kidding me. Stop. You gotta be kidding me. You gotta be kidding me. That ain't no victory chant. That ain't no victory chant. We're gonna lift it up.
Yes.
So, hear what? I'm getting ready for us to pray for this little young lady.
Mighty God.
This little young lady suffers from seizure. Jesus knows about that.
Hallelujah.
Yeah, 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 yeah. So let's declare victory and then we'll pray over her. Come on.
Victory is mine.
I gotta go faster.
Victory is mine. Victory today is mine. Oh, I told Satan to get thee behind.
Victory, oh, victory,
victory today is mine.
Oh, come on, let's declare victory.
Victory is mine. Victory is mine.
Victory,
victory today is mine.
playing.
Hallelujah.
Now shall we point our hands towards her? You keep playing, Victorisma. I want you to point your hands towards her. Our goal is to command sickness and diseases to go. Amen.
Oh my God.
Our command is to drive sickness and diseases out, right? Shall we do it together?
Amen.
Because one shall chase 1,002. 10,000. So let's do it together in the name of Jesus. Seizure, we reverse you and curse you. Be gone from her body now. Never to return. In the name of Jesus. Fix her neurologically, Lord God. Fix every brain cell, every vein, every blood vessel. Oh God, get inside and make everything that's wrong right. In Jesus' name, be healed. 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 In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Oh, victory today is mine.
Victory is mine. Victory is mine.
Baba baba kashanda la
rosha. Victory today is mine. I don't sit down to get the behind. Victory today is mine. Oh yes, Lord, victory. Victory,
victory,
today is mine.
is ours today. Hallelujah. What more do we want him to do to prove that he loves us? You see, God show up. God certainly show up. And he did his will. Hallelujah. I'm going to invite Minister Phillips, Minister Renee Phillips, and her husband, Reverend Dr. Gareth Phillips. And are the children here? And I'm going to ask Kamisha and Tanisha to come forward. Church, what an awesome day. People, no worship God, don't feel the fire. Don't feel the blaze. Wow. Wow, wow, wow. Oh my God. Somebody just worship God. You don't need people to pump in or fry. You have your fire. You just keep the fire burning. My God. God is good. We would like the board of directors that works with Reverend Phillips, if you're here. And so, the National Ladies Department, Reverend Phillips, Minister Renee, children, those who have served with you, Rev. You have been elected since 2016. And we are now in the year 2024. And we just want to say to you how thankful we are. You have done well. You have served well. And we really love and appreciate you, your wife, and your kids, and your board. And I must say, I must let the people also know that Minister Renee, she serves as the Assistant National Ladies President. Tanisha serves on the committee, and I can tell you what Reverend Phillips preached today like never before. The anointing of God show up in this place. And what God wants we as the people to understand, it's not about us, but it is about God. And so, we are happy that the Lord has chosen you for a time such as 2016. And the team sent, acronym S, served, E, endure, N, nurture, T, teach. For my grace is sufficient, and that's God. 2017, together, we can achieve, because God has broken the chain. So let's go possess the land. 2018, the church. We need to understand the church, not the building, but the people. We are the church, God's vanguard. It is by his spirit have we seen that evident this afternoon. 2019, out of your belly shall shall rivers of living water flow. Have you seen that here this evening, the church? Mighty God. 2020, COVID. And despite that, the fire was still there. The fire was still there. And it took some people to fan the fire. To fan the fire. Glory to God. So 2021, the glory of the latter temple will be greater than the former, says the Lord of hosts. Look what the Lord has done. Like Elijah, you hand the mantle to the Davis. Glory to God. Can the church give God some glory in this place? Hallelujah. Mighty God. 2022. Empowering the next generation to go forth. Lord of mercy, the next generation, they are about to explode because of the fire and the persons who have been fanning the mighty God. Are you getting it, church? Can I come like summer? We now get this. In 2023, transforming our cities. Did you watch the young man walk? Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I will draw. So you can't see people. You have to obey God's word and watch God do his thing. Have you seen the transformation? Hallelujah. And last but not least, 2024, ignite the fire of God in you. We want to say to you, man of God and woman of God, you may be leaving as the president, but God is taking you to a higher level. Let the church say higher level. Let the church say higher level. And so we want you to know, sir and madam, children, board, team, we have been empowered, impact, inspired, transform, and trust me, we're gonna keep the fire ablaze because we can see difference. You see, she's my assistant. I love her. I love this woman, and I know she loves me. I know that. You must know when people love you. And so she's so humble, and just enough for wait. But Renee is always there as a great support. And you see, she don't take them simple. And I remember coming to convention as a young girl. I always watch pastors' wives, two beautiful young lady, and they were serving. Look what the Lord has done. And at this time, I could go on and on and on. So our committee, myself, Renee, Tanisha, Kemisha from Bagnall Spring, and Peter Gay from Tarrington. Our newly president, we know you're gonna do mighty work. And I know they will continue to support. Sister Tanisha will do the presentation.
Of the National Ladies Department, we are so proud to present this little token to the Phillips family. We love you, we appreciate you, and we know that the fire will continue to burn.
Amen. Amen. Reverend English.
Shall we praise the Lord? Bless the Lord. The fire has been ignited. Amen. And I'm going to ask, we are unusually early. So in the previous years to COVID, 6 o'clock, we would just be starting the last session. And we are about finishing. So I'm going to ask those people who are leaving, if you could just wait until this session comes to an end. Amen. We give God thanks and praise for the way he showed up in this place. And I am here to do the vote of thanks. I hope tonight I will not... I hope tonight I will not give anybody any new names. Amen? Amen. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And here goes. So those persons who are walking out, just bear with us a little bit. Amen. After much fasting and prayer by the board of directors, God gave the theme, Igniting the Fire of God in You. After careful consideration and prayer, the speakers were chosen. As we drew nearer to the date, 3 days of fasting and prayer were held, and truly God heard our prayers. And here we are at the end of another wonderful convention. To our national praise team, who ensure that the stage was set for the continuation of each inspiring session, we say to God be the glory, and thanks for the great effort made through the inspiration of the Holy Ghost, the fire was truly ignited. Our overseas participants, thank you for taking the time to come to Jamaica for this special occasion, and we truly hoped that you were blessed. Special thanks to Reverend Aaron Hunter, FMI Global Associate Director, our opening night's speaker, who reminded us to get into the Word of God and should read, understand, and apply his words. A life of prayer is essential if we are to have deep fellowship with God. He also charged our newly elected president, Reverend Richard Davis. And a part of his charge was for him not to forget that it is God who called him. Thanks to Pastor Dean Smith and his team for carrying through our praise party entitled Flames of Worship. Our hearts were truly blessed. Reverend Dr. Peter Burnett, who reminded us that we should not be too busy to sit around the fire to catch the fire and to protect the fire. Thank you for the message that was well received. Thanks to the organizers of our presidential, blessed be the name of the Lord, I'm going a little bit too fast. I missed one thing. Praise the name of Jesus. All right. Thanks to the organization of our presidential installation service. I'm sure it inspired members of the next generation to aspire for that position. Blessed be the name of Jesus. Thanks to Brother Devin Forrest, who blessed us with his awesome voice in singing praises to the King. Bishop Dr. Roy Notice encouraged us not to be counterfeit Christians and that we should ignite the fire. Blessed be the name of Jesus, and that it involves the young people. Thank you wholeheartedly, Bishop. Special thanks to our very own Reverend Joseph Nelson, who spoke passionately and informed us that to ignite the fire, we should repent, feed the fire, and clean out the ashes. To our immediate past president, Reverend Dr. Gareth Phillips, a heartfelt thank you for your 8 years of undaunting service and to have delivered the ultimate message at this, our 54th annual National Convention. Thank you for pointing out to us what we should do to help set the next generation to come to know our God. He reminded us that love for God is the passion. The thing that is inside of us is to keep us going. Bless the Lord. Thanks to the leaders and conveyors of the children's ministry, your efforts help them to experience God in a different way, and for that, and for them to recognize that serving God is indeed enjoyable. Our special choir, Voices of Foursquare, thanks for your melodious renditions, which truly blessed our hearts. Choir director, you did an exceptional job. To the hospitality team, the cooks, and everyone who helped in the kitchen, job well done. The meals were very delicious to the point where people craved for seconds. The engineer and media team, without you, this convention could not have been what it was. Thank you for going beyond the call of duty to ensure that the YouTube channel was up and running and that persons all over the globe were tuned in to our convention. Our musicians, what would convention be without you? Thank God for the skills you are blessed with. You have used it to really enhance the sessions, and to God be the glory. The prayer team, who continued in prayer for the speakers and the various sessions, may God continue to bless and keep you as you continue to pray. To our ushers, security, and all those who lend an helping hand in one way or another, thank you for your support. To the pastors, ministers, leaders, and all 27 churches represented, thanks for the convention offering, your gifts in kind, and the sacrificial giving throughout the convention. As you journey back home, may God go with you and may you arrive home safely. Our convention planning team, kudos to you for the great effort you made in ensuring that all areas were covered. What a convention we have had. Even in the face that it seems as if things were very tough, but the Lord has seen us through. Have I missed anybody? Please tell me quickly. I tried. Have we missed anybody? for those who cleaned, I think they came under our security and all who lend a helping hand. Blessed be the name of the Lord. But thank you for the job that you did in keeping the place clean. The bathrooms. We have to say to those persons who were responsible, you did an awesome, awesome job. Put your hands together for them. It's not very often that you have such a great congregation and you go into a bathroom and it is that clean. And so we say thank you very, very much. The media team at this time is going to come forward. But I forgot to talk about the persons who helped us in the business meeting, the organizers. We give God glory for the way the meeting was conducted. And we thank God for him showing up. Blessed be the name of the Lord. We also thank God for our newly elected president, Reverend Richard Davis. We're going to ask him to stand. And his beautiful wife. And I want you to put your hands together as they take over the reins. And we know that God will give you the shoes, because you were told to find and walk in your own shoes. So you will have your own shoes, you will be Richard, and you will do what God has commanded you to do. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And the board wants to say to all of us, we have an initiative that is coming up. And I want all 27 churches, 26 and a half, but we're going to get the 27th one back. Blessed be the name of the Lord. To buy into this initiative. And it is that in our lives being spared in 2025, we are going to be having an in-gathering that starts from this year. From convention to convention. And our target is not less than $3.5 million. Una na believe it? So I don't hear anybody saying, yes, Lord. $3.5 million, that's the base target. It must be more, but not less. And so every pastor, every district supervisor, every church, every members, we are going to be leaving here with this on our minds. And the proceeds from it will go to repair our very dear camp. It's just a drop in the bucket for Camp Curtis. We hear about our summer camp coming up. Amen. It's just going to be a drop in the bucket, but we are going to do it. Do you believe that we can? Do you believe that we can? So we are going to do whatever it takes. So the base that any church should be coming up is about $127,000. That is, if we really want to do that, because some of us put on one rally and we make that, right? One program, one choir in praise, or whatever it is, and we make that. So next year, this time, we are all going to come with our gifts, monetary gifts, to present unto the Lord. And we will have a great time. As churches, you will get to come up and do your items and give thanks for what God has done for you. So we are going to be having an in-gathering party. You don't believe that? So we are going to sing and shout and praise the Lord. Media team, it's your time. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Do we believe it?
Yes.
I want us to say, yes, we can.
Yes, we
are going to do it. And it's going to be more than $3.5 million. No man only this side believe that. It is going to be more than $3.5 million. Thank you very much for your help. The media team, don't leave. This is the last thing. The media team is coming now to make a presentation. Put your hands together as they come. Bless the Lord. If you know the Lord is keeping you, what are you gonna worry about? I'm just singing for them to come. Oh, it's behind me? Amen. Hallelujah.
To see my pastor, Reverend Reuben Dave. And his wife. That is at the point that you're caught up. You just slip away from the pulpit for a minute and you just start up. Time since 2023 that my pastor has been able to come into the sanctuary, and I know he wants to be here, but physically he can't, and that's why when he walked up in here this afternoon, I wanted to just cut loose. I know I'm supposed to. I know we've come into a dignified service. I know we came for a wonderful formal service, but give me 2 minutes. I myself. I'll take it. Oh, my kids know that I praise. Not just when I come into the sanctuary. I run through the house and start praising. And they will just say, watch him again. He's at it again. Because there's something. The Bible says, when I think of his goodness and all that he's done for me, my soul cries out, thank God for saving me. Surely, so we're on time. We're on limited time here this afternoon because Pastor might not be able. You see, I'm going to praise for him. I'm going to give God honor for him because when the devil says no,